whānau Wapanui. And anyway, my auntie saw it, she knows that whare, and she bawled out. So this young fella gave it. And they brought it down, it's beautiful. I love it. That whare got a, like a, it like a person, eh? Some eyes and a nose. Tell some stories, eh? And those trees like two guardians. Sort of a bit tropical looking, eh?
Kia ora.
So we got a lot of whares, and this one we call pare. Now pare is my little daughter saw before, but also my mum, my grandmother, my great-grandmother. Pare. One of my mum's name. Have a seat over here. So, money, I said money, not the problem. You see, this house, in fact, the whole place is all carcasses from Mitsubishi Motors. Before Mitsubishi Motors were called Todd Motors. And all the timber we pull out of old buildings, these beautiful windows, eh? We pull them out. They used to throw them away. Pākehā threw all the good things away. And we grab them. But now they want them back. Too late, because to buy windows like that today cost you a fortune. People getting them made. But they threw them all away. And all this beautiful wood, we saved it. And all the walls, they're just coffee sacks. We got for nothing. A lovely texture. This whole story in here is about my mum. We've done by my son and I, mostly my son. I gave him a hand. Starts over here. If you stay there, I can point it out. This is the baby here. In the womb, a baby girl. And then these are sort of the blood colours. Most of the colour is here, where the baby is born. And here's a little baby with a little petal and a little bum, and very simple in the head, like a fish, simple. And then she grows up, this little baby girl, and she's a little girl from about 3 to 10 or 11, 12, and it's, the whole head is like dancing, and it's flowing in a dumpy little body, but magic, the magic age. It's a pity we didn't stay little boys and little girls. Here I am 60 now, I love to be a little boy. And the beauty about having little kids is it keeps you to be little magic. And you can be like the little ones and walk. And never to lose the magic, eh? I should never lose the boy in me. And a sister made me do that. I want the magic to stay, eh? The magic child. This one here is a teenager, and she's skinny. She got one hip up a bit higher than the other one. Lots scattered there in the head. Slim, long legs. That's a normal teenager. And this one here is the full woman, very strong. Next to one of my Tipuna. And it's showing her very strong. And of course, in a whare like this, we have the old people. This one over here is my grandmother and grandfather. And my grandmother there, she's pregnant with my mother. All these people are gone now. They're all my uncles. So she died when before Mum was born. All pregnant women died in those days. 1918. They died in the thousands. Not only pregnant women. Māori died. We nearly. The Māori race was nearly wiped out then. But my mummy survived. Till she's 37. That's all. So that's about that. And this is the same story again, the woman. This is the fire of love in the bed. And this one here is about conception. Two heads locked together. Central figure here is always woman though. And this one here is about the protection of the child, this new child, and the child umbilical cord is connected to the mother, Papa Tuanuku. And here's the mind, Hinengaro, coming into the mind of the child. And this little child, of course, is Pare, my mother. This one over here, I love this sculpture, my son done. It's of the, it's called Tapu Te, of the woman reaching her full potential. Like a flower that, you know, it's been growing and then the winter, asleep in the spring come and the summer, voila, the full potential, the flower, eh? Which I think is the ultimate goal of the human being, is to reach your full potential. The old people had it, eh? They lost their way like every other race. But that concept is a beautiful one. What is the ultimate goal? Why are we here? And for me, it's te pua waitanga, to reach our full potential. And it has nothing to do with dollar. Nothing. Nothing to do with dollar. To reach your full potential. And that's just, the rope makes it strong. Here's the body, and the head is, because you got your thinking down here, and that's more rugby league thinking and good stuff. And BMWs and all that kind of thinking, that's the bottom half of the body. The higher half is the head, eh? So a lot of our pōwhenua had very big head, most of it head, developing this part, not down here. So I love that, developing our upper body. And so over here, this is that same woman, that primitive artist woman who spent a lot of time in psychiatric wards, and I love this one, it's the mother and child, the Madonna. Whatever different version you do of it. A great symbol, eh? The mother and child, eh? And for me, that's what Tapu Te Ranaga is about. Making a home for the children, eh? And the children to come. Because I don't trust the system, eh? sister not going to look after them. They say that we all got to run this race. I don't even want to be in their race. So this is Pare. There's a lovely painting over here, one couple that I like. Yeah, that's a Goldie. Yeah, they're alright, they're worth a few bob, but that's not a very valuable one. Pen and ink one, it's a genuine Goldie apparently. But they're not like the Māori artists. That one there's a Robley. It's very famous. Because that pa at Makitu, that was painted in 1865, and that's a genuine watercolour. But it's not like the Māori ones. It's a record of a place. But see this one of Fred Graham here, one of the Māori artists. So beautiful. It's all flowing. See Taranaki? Everything's flowing. And then the plough paddocks. Te Raukura, the feathers. The Māori son being eclipsed by a Pākehā. They were put in jail for ploughing those paddocks. Mm. Beautiful. So when I wake up, I am at the museum. I am at the art gallery. I like this art gallery better than the National Art Gallery. But this is not, every whānau should live in the art. We should live again in our marae. This one over here. This is Darcy Nicholas. It's one of Darcy's best. Well, Darcy says it is, so I think it is too. The night time and the sun goes down, it's like a camera. You're catching little sort of flash in the lens, sort of way back from where the sun's coming, almost like the lens shot, you know, you can see the reflection. Mm-hmm. And here's all Ngā Aitua, the spirits, all the faces. A lot of kids have a lot of fun seeing how many faces they can see. In the shadows, as the night comes again. The spirits are there, eh? I love it. You can see the, got that gold feeling. It's sunset, eh? It's sunset more than it's sunrise, isn't it? Sort of sunset. And everything is gold, eh? Yeah. Darcy Nicholas. Where are you going?
As we're talking before. I'm just...
What are we talking about?
You know how you just come out of hospital and how you feel about that?
What?
About your operation, your heart operation.
Yeah, I wrote something very recently, and I've got it on the wall in my house. From now on, I will live each moment like it is my last. And that's not because I'm looking down on things, because actually because I want to make every moment precious. Because I was, I've only been come out from cardiac surgery just over 2 weeks. And I really fuel. I always know there's a reason for some things, and reason for me going in, I get a better heart at a triple bypass, but I observe some things in there. And you see, I smoke, but I don't smoke a lot. And the night before surgery, the surgeon says to me and my family that there's a big risk factor with you. You smoke. Of course, if you tell them you smoke 10 a day, they triple it. Everyone, how many do you smoke 10 a day? I triple it or something. How much do you drink? And I'd seen the warnings. I knew smoking wasn't good for your health. It can cause heart disease, but not me, because I'm always fit and strong. And then the physiotherapist came to me and said, because of your smoking, you've killed some part of your lung, and you're going to struggle to get enough breath in the recovery. I thought, yeah, that's all right. I'm fit and strong. I'll do it. But there I was, even with the oxygen on, all night long, trying to get enough air into my lungs, because there's a terrible feeling that you're winded, you haven't got enough air, and if you're running, it's all right, you can stop and get some air in, but if you're just sitting still, you can't stop because you already stopped, you know? And you just got to try and get more air in because you're suffocating. You're winded. You can't get enough air in. Boy, I fought. I never slept 2 days, 3 days. I just concentrated on sitting up. Big breath. Trying to get enough air in. So my lung would kick in, and I've only been smoking 10 years. I mean, that's too much, but I really have only been smoking 10 years. I can see why the surgeons turn a lot of people down, and I think of our Māori women, a lot of them smoking. That's why I'm saying this thing. I'm not trying to be holier than thou. I'm just thinking of the health thing. And some Māoris came in while I was inside. And they, emergencies. They were brought in on a chopper. They were brought in an ambulance, rushed up. Some put onto a machine while the surgeons did all their things, and they gathered the families together, and I talked to some of the family, and I said, 50-50 chance, but we're going to take the risk. And I never saw those Māori families come back. That means she went, had a surgery, this mother, and never made it. So, healthy. Health for me is you have a dream, but we got to look after our body. Boy, I love muesli now. And non-fat yogurt. And fruit. And fresh vegetables. I love the sun. I love life. Eh? I love the kids' laughter. I got little babies. I want to be here a long time for them. I'm no good dead to them. I'm no good at all dead. I want to be a good daddy, eh? It's pretty tough, about 60 years old being a daddy, but I actually love it in a lot of ways. But now I'm coming right. summer with my babies. And I want them to take over this place. All the kids. This is their place. I just put down the foundation, eh? I never own it. I don't want to own it. I took it out of my name a long time ago. Not ownership, not dollar. That's important. What is important is love, eh? That's the only thing that's important. There's nothing else. Love. Of course, it's what my mother taught me, but I didn't realize it. When I made myself sick, so I didn't go to any prize-giving ceremony because she's so black and fat. She never said one word. Just loved me. She said something, I would have denied it all, of course. Told more lies. All she did was love me. I think it's the only thing that's important. Love, eh? Enough? Go on and get boring, eh? But, there's enough in that. It's not, I didn't want it to come across like, there's a big reason for this, not just a, you know what I mean? Not just a, oh, I can't lift my finger even that much. Eh?
Well, this would be good.
Hey, right there. You're on TV now. Hey. Picky. Picky. Hey, picky. This one here. We did a, they carved a Po Whenua out of, weighed 2 ton, Omaru stone. We carved it here, to the Rangi Haiata in Te Raupapa. It's up a big hill, up the back, you can't see it from here. And night time, we started to pull it up. All the afternoon, right up the hill. And there's it coming to its final resting place, and I was taking the photos. And of course, it's a magnificent Po Whenua, so beautifully carved, of Te Raupapa and Te Rangi Haiata. And why I did it of them, because I was taught that they were awful people. My history teacher said they were rubbish, scoundrels. What? Ooh, he's a hard case to kill me. Wait. Right? I want my glasses, eh? You want my glasses. So, when they're pulling up, and I didn't take anything of the Po Whenua, just of the boys pulling. Because I think what they were pulling, the fact that they were pulling, more important than what they were putting. Even my son, one of my sons there, I see he got a cigarette in his mouth. I can tell by his shape, even though it was years ago. And he shouldn't have had a cigarette in his mouth because it was very tapu with what we're doing. Doesn't matter, eh? Because there it is up on the hill there. For everyone to see. We need to put our heroes up on the hill. I have heroes. We need to follow the hero's path, eh? I'm going to leave a little thread for us to follow. So, everything we do is, we're actually doing it for ourselves. It's of Te Rauparaha and Te Rangi Haida, but you're creating yourself, right? So that's the whole idea behind it, eh? One day it'll be these one job to pull. Might be DNA be doing something different, eh? One of the things I'm sad about Māori is we lost our drum, eh? Nearly every night, every day we dance, the kids play drum, dance, eh? She loves it. Where mum went? Go on. We should never smack our children. I never want to smack children. Don't you smack them. Another way. Better way than smack. Beautiful. We have about 9,000 people a year come, you know. And we used to say we have one hui a week average, and sometimes now we average three a day. People from all over the world come. And the place inspires them. I think that's probably the biggest thing. You're led by inspiration. You as a journalist often are inspired by something you see. Think, gee, oh, I could have done that. I could have done that. That's me. And you're inspired by that. And see that picture there. I'm inspired by a great shot called Raising the Flag at Iwo Jima. All these soldiers were raising this flag. And as soon as I glance at my camera, I see that Raising the Flag shot. But the why I got the shock from the raising the flag at Iwo Jima. I was inspired. I don't know who the photographer. Probably a famous photographer, eh? Who took the shot where these men raised the flag. But for me, that was a similar shot. The boys pulling, eh? At last, we all pulled together. The shot of Marae, the mate. And that rope's tight, eh? You can see it's tight, not a pretend. And look at the lean those fellas on. A big pull. Toy. Big pull. I think that when we got here, I didn't want. First thing I done was I painted over the 44, because 44 Rhine Street. And the system wants to give us all numbers. We got a. Bank number, tax number, street number. Wonder if schools, the kids have got numbers. As well as their name. But in the old days, of course, was a name, so I want to find a name for here. So I dream about the island, and they tell me the island called Goat Island. No, it can't be there. Rat Island, no. So I look it up, archives. Tapu Te Ranaga. And you see, the old way, we light our cooking fire, we light our fire. And the people come into the valley and they say, oh, someone live here, look at, can see the smoke. Somebody already stay here. They got their fire, ahika. The fire's going. We better sneak around here and find another valley where we can settle down. And so, even in the summer, you know, when our visitors come, we always light our fire. And the smoke goes up, just to show that we're in occupation, and we never, well hardly, I don't think we ever leave the place unoccupied. We're always here. Someone's here. In all cultures they talk about the hearth and the fire. Same with Marae, ahika. It's not to say you own the land, it means you occupy. I owned all this. I gave it away because I want to be free of it. I don't want my own house and a mortgage and a bloody lawn to do, paint to fix up, and insurance and rape, all for my own house. I wanted to be free. To put all my energy into. So that's our ahika. We keep it warm. Eh? And the children can go away. Our children have belonged to here, but we keep it warm for them. if they come back. Eh? Someone keep it warm at home so they come back. They might want to go away and study, just go for a holiday. That's their right. We can't stop them, eh? But they come back and say, I want to belong. I belong to here. My great-grandmother come from here. I read it in a letter and I don't belong anywhere. And where do I belong here? Yes, you do. You belong here. This is your place.